There is something powerful about a mother's love, but there is also something very unique and very impactful about the faith of a mother. He said, the faith that I see in you, the champion that I see in you, I've seen this before. Some of y'all looking at me crazy. Then, well, Pastor JP, guess what? That was cute. My grandmother didn't grow up in church. My grandmother wasn't a person of faith. So what about me? What do I do? First thing I have to say to you is neither was mine. But God used me. In fact, I baptized my mom. You can be the person who God uses to change a whole generation. I made a decision that whatever baggage our family carried had to stop with us. Listen, the next thing he says, because you have faith in God, I need you to move in the power of God. Listen now, what power you have available to you? He says, I need you to do me a favor. I need you to take the faith that you have and be willing to move forward in the power of God and fan into flame, watch this, the gift that is in you. Now, I can fan the flame and the Holy Spirit will give me the power that I need for the gifts he's given me to not just flow, but overflow. God placed the gift in me. I've got to trust him to empower it so I can be everything that God's called me to be. You know what he tells him next? Don't be timid. Listen, what I need you to do for me is I need you to be Timothy and not Timidy. Don't let the environment around you make you timid. Don't let the people around you make you timid. I'd rather things go bad in God's will than my will, because if I'm in his will, it's his responsibility to make sure that it works out for my good and for his glory. That's why he tells Timothy, no, keep on fanning the flame. You cannot do this assignment without my power, without my grace. So keep on fanning the flame. Fear has killed more dreams than failure. So God is saying, when you're not timid and you trust me to go forward, I will empower you. I will strengthen you to overcome obstacles and danger. And in the end, God will get the glory.
Well, praise the Lord, family. Praise the Lord, family. We've been walking through a series called Walk It Out, and we've walked through worship, humanity, and then last week we went over forgiveness. And today we're going to walk out God's blessing plan. How many know God blesses you? Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we pray over the word that goes forth today, Lord. We pray it is equipping. We pray it is edifying to the body. Lord, when we started off praying, Lord, and we worship, we said that you are the Alpha, you are the Omega. And then, Lord, you're a good father, Lord. And then we called on the names of Jehovah, Lord, and we thank you for what you're doing in our lives. And then now we said you're good. And now, Lord, as you walk through your word today, Lord, Lord, minimize me and maximize you, Lord. And these practical things that you have blessed us with, Lord, let us walk in the strength that you have for us. And let us be the loving people, caring people, and sharing people that you would have us to be, and fertile ground. Lord, we say this prayer in the name of Jesus. And all the blessed people of God said, amen, amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Well, praise the Lord. So God is in the blessing business. I'm actually going to show you how God is in the blessing business. But first, I just want to ask you a question. Do you ever notice that some people are more blessed than others? Or have you ever been out and you said, why is this person more blessed than I am? They just had this car. They got blessed with this. And does God have a blessing plan for me? Well, guess what? He does, and I'm going to walk you through it. So first, there's a scripture I'd like to share with you. It's Psalms 24 and 1. And by the way, before I share the scripture, I love this scripture. I don't have a tattoo, but if I did, probably Jeremiah 29 11 be right here, and then this one be right here. You want to why be here? Because I'm talking about my daddy in this one. Psalms 24 and 1. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all that live in it. This says three things. The first thing that this says, it says, the earth is the Lord's. That means God created everything. If you open the Bible, the first five words of the word, the fifth word in the Bible is God created. In the beginning, God created. He created everything. So that means that God created everything, so that's his. And it says, everything in the world. This is the beauty of it. That means God can sustain you. Let me give it to you again. God created it, but then he sustains it. In other words, like, God blesses you with everything. Your car, your house. But see, he doesn't want to just be a home buyer. He wants you to be a home owner because he can sustain it. When God puts them there, that means he can sustain it. So everything in the earth, he does, and then that's yours. It's a mindset change. You see, when God owns everything, you're a steward over it. That means that if he owns everything, back to the tattoo, that means you own everything. You've got to be a steward over it. That means there's no lack. The enemy wants to tell you that you don't have something. God created you to do good works, and he blesses you in that. So now, how do you get to the next level? I want to show you, how do you get to the next level and what God has for you? But before we get to the next level, we first got to figure out, what level are you at? Everybody, you're at one of five levels. The first level, struggling and sinking. That means you have the inability to pay your current bills. Next level, steady. We're going to do testimony time later, y'all. Next level, steady. You have just enough to pay your bills, but if something snap, crackles, or pops, you fall down to struggling. Next level, solid. That means you've been doing pretty well, work somewhere for a while, take a one-week vacation, you know, take a vacation, 401k, you know, doing that. Next level, surplus. That's extra money. You guys remember, like, I was in college and used to, you know, when you didn't have a lot of money and you would go to get a menu at a restaurant and you kind of look at the prices and then say, oh, I can afford that. And then you look across and see, do I like that? That's not surplus. Surplus is extra money, right? Highest level of service. Let's go. Services, you're not concerned with finances at all. You're doing whatever God puts you on this earth to do. So right now you're looking and saying, what level am I at? One. And then also, what level is my family at? Like, where am I at? And then also, this is not just finances. Remember, struggling, steady, solid, surplus, service. Where are you in the area of health? Where are you in your spiritual walk? Where are you with God, what God promised you? Where are you at in that area? So right now, I'm going to walk through how to get to the next level in God by doing this. Amen? Everybody hold up four fingers. There's four areas that God blesses you in. Every day he blesses you in these areas. The first is that he blesses you with is time. Someone say time. He blesses you with time. The Bible says in Ephesians 5, 15 through 17, look carefully how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise. I want to stop right here, but I'm going to keep reading. Make the best use, verse 16, of your time, because the days are evil. Verse 17, therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Let's look at the top. That's saying three things. The first thing that's saying is this. It's saying, walk wise. Do you guys see the mistake we don't want to make is that we say, it doesn't say don't make mistakes. It's saying walk wise. That means if you do make a mistake, just don't keep repeating it. You know, don't do something dumb. I'm sorry, I didn't say that. Did I say that? Did I say don't do something dumb? I didn't mean that. I'm sorry. Oh, what's another way? Let me clean that up. That's me rewinding the tape. Don't make an ill-advised decision. I done cleaned it up.
and then followed up with another.
But people do this all the time financially. I'm in debt. Let me borrow some more money. Right. You can't borrow your way out of debt. So what happens if we make a decision? If we have a problem, you know what the first thing you do? It's just stop. Just stop. Because then people all come around you saying, hey, we want to give you a rope to get out of the ditch. But what they're actually doing is they're giving you a shovel so you can dig deeper. God is saying, just stop. I own it. I'll take care of it. You be a good steward over it. And then what happens is you learn how to stop wasting things. Number one thing you guys don't want to waste is time. Moses, look at how many miracles he saw in his ministry. If I go through all the miracles in the Bible, you know, you pick one, you know, raising Lazarus from the dead, that'd be kind of up there. You know what I mean? That'd be kind of up there. You know what I mean? Then you guys say, the walking on water, that'd probably be one. But Moses had one that was just the most, what's the word other than gangster? Okay, I'll use that. Gangster. Could you imagine Pharaoh chasing you, all the people there, you got the women, kids, all with you running. Now all of a sudden just drive a stake, bam, and part the seas. That's up there. That's up there. He saw that. But Moses' assignment was to take the people to the promised land. Someone say promised land. And when he wanted to take them to the promised land, he went out and walked around, but I'm using a different word, wandered around in the wilderness for 40 years. How long did they wander around in the wilderness? 40 years. 40 years they went around. Them same people that saw him part the sea were complaining, where my lunch money at? My foot sore. These shoes you got me, these Jerusalem shoes, these shoes ain't the right shoes. 40 years they walked around. Do you guys know that if they would have walked from point A to point B, do you know how long that would have taken? 11 days. I came here to teach somebody something today. If you study the laws of geometry, you don't have to take the whole class. I'm going to give you the cheat sheet. The laws of geometry, the shortest distance between point A to point B is a straight line. I came by here to tell somebody today, you need to start taking the straight line. Right now, look at what you're doing in your life where you're wasting time and what God has for you in your purpose, in your business, at work, relationship. Don't want to talk about the relationships, right? But think about that. Time is valuable. Time is valuable. How valuable is it, Pastor George? Every day, God blesses you with 86,400 seconds every day. Bam, like a clock. And it ticks off every day, like a bank. You can't come back and say, you know what? Yesterday, I couldn't do the blessings. I want to go ahead and get a refund. You can't do that. Somebody tell me yesterday's blessing, you want to come back and get it. God bless you with tender mercies every morning. That clock is running. And then I want to tell you another lie that's told out all the time. People get up and tell this lie. Time is money. Time ain't money. Hold on, I've worked in the financial industry for over 20 years, 26 years. Time is not money. Time is more valuable than money. Hold on, we'll do this. Let me give you an example. If I told you right now I want to give you $1 million, you'd say, oh, I want to take it, right? Right, everybody say, I want to take it, right? But then if I said, at the end of the day, at 5 o'clock, you have to die, meaning there won't be a tomorrow, you wouldn't take the $1 million. You wouldn't take it. Because you want to know why? Because you can always get money. You can always get it. So say, George, that's not true. The Federal Reserve is printing money as we speak. They print money all the time. And number two, there is no shortage of money in the United States. Okay, wait. You might have a shortage. Who am I preaching? Don't wave at me.
But there ain't no shortage.
You see, but what happens is God blesses you with time. Use it. God, so when he does that, so time is a blessing. Someone say time is a blessing. So remember I told you there's four things? God bless you with time, but he don't bring you in here empty-handed. God also blesses you with talent. Did I tell you that I don't have a tattoo? I don't have a tattoo. But if I did, this would probably be right on this one right over here. That was for Psalm 24 and 1. This right here, I would have another tattoo. I don't have a tattoo, but if I did, it would be simply in Ephesians 2 and 10. And when I taught new members, I did that. And hey, Patrick, you want to get a tattoo with me? Hey, at the end of service, we're getting tattoos. We're putting the scriptures right up here, okay? Right, okay, gotcha. Ephesians 2 and 10. Let's go to work. For we are God's handiwork. Somebody should have shouted on there, but that's okay. Created in Christ Jesus. That's two. To do good works as he prepared in advance for us to do. Did you see when they said we're God's handiwork? Do you understand that? You are literally, you are a masterpiece. There is no one like you in the world. No one. Some of you know this, but just in case you don't, I'm a twin. I have a twin sister, and I have twin sons, twin boys. All of us have different fingerprints. All of us have different skill sets. All of us like or dislike different foods. God made us in uniqueness. There are billions of people on this planet, but there's only one you. Stop trying to imitate other people. They're already taken. You God's masterpiece. You need to get up in the morning. Say, this is the day the Lord has made. I'll rejoice and be glad in it. Then you need to look in the mirror, throw your shoulders back, and just say, won't he do it? You know why you said he ain't did it for nobody else? He did it for you. So he puts you, he made you, and then he gives you a talent or a skill. It's almost like you guys, it's like when I see this, I see an image of an arena. He puts you in an arena, and he gives you the ability to perform. It can be a track. It can be a basketball. You guys watch, Steph Curry. I would say LeBron, but this morning when I said that, people wanted me to pray for him and come up here this morning and do it. But take your pick, Michael Jordan, anybody. You watch athletes perform in an arena, and what they're doing, they're showing their gift. And the same gift that you see on TV or the same gift you see out there is the same gift in here. You have that gift. You actually get to witness it also when we do praise and worship. Where's Kirk at? Kirk, come over here, Kirk. I'm going to show you guys this example of a spiritual gift. My man. So, Kurt didn't know this, but during the pandemic, I used to have to, when I did the offering and everything like that, and by the way, he did an excellent job, got up there and said he was George Thompson and everything. Y'all hear that? Good. But I used to do it by myself, and I was just so, I don't even say it was just hard for me to do it. It was just harder for me, and I was just doing it because I was at home during the pandemic, and I was just doing it. So I started coming in during praise and worship with them. And this is the first thing I want to tell you. Kirk does not practice worship. He is worship. He does worship. When I came in, he wasn't like, hey, let's do a song. He just stood up. He would stand up and go, let's get ready. He goes, let's worship. And then he would start, and then he would start in the band. Everybody, that's a spiritual gift. God placed that on him so that he does that. And then in doing that, level two, when you have a spiritual gift, which I'm gifted in another area other than singing, so what happens is I would come in, and while he's has his gift, I'm with him in my gift. So then we can move faster together. Have you guys ever, anybody here ever ridden a horse? Anybody here ever ridden a horse? Okay. Gotcha. Wow, a lot of horses. Okay. Anybody ever, the people who didn't raise your hand, anybody here ever seen a horse? Okay. They have this thing. It's called Hollywood Park out there. Okay. Hollywood Park. Gotcha. So horses can move three ways. The first way a horse can move is a horse can walk. Okay? So if a horse walks, it walks. I'm getting there. Don't get ahead of me, brother. A horse walks about 4 miles an hour. Then a horse can do something called trot. Then a horse can trot between 4 to 12 miles an hour. Then a horse can gallop. When a horse gallops, a horse can gallop 40 miles an hour. Most up to 40 miles an hour. So do you understand that in life right now, many times we're just walking. Some of us are trotting. That means the whole work hard thing. Like, I'm going to work more hours and do this and that. But you're not working in your gift and what God has for you. But then when you start working in the gift, then you begin to gallop. Then this is the good part, Minister. Then the Holy Spirit gets involved. I'm coming back to you, Kurt. They got these horses. And they're called thoroughbreds. They can go faster than 40 miles an hour. They can get up to 55 miles an hour. When they're running, there's points where their feet are not even touching the ground because the Spirit is lifting them. And when this man gets up and does worship, our feet aren't touching the ground because what's happening is we're lifting. And then he is a gift, and the same gift that he was given to him is the same gift that you have. We got to use our gifts. Give Kirk a hand. It's the same area. You may be a school teacher. We have some teachers for my kids. I watch how gifted they are in just patience and work patience, working with the kids, and they're doing it. They have that area. You also may be a business owner, and you have that gift. Start operating in your gift. And then also, when you have your gift, just in any area there are. So also, many of you are writing down notes, or I'm sorry, if you're under 40, you might want to type them. You know, I know nobody writing that no more. But when you have your operating in your gifts, start to celebrate them. You see, like when you're a teacher, look at that. When someone graduates, celebrate that. I get so excited when people come to me as a financial advisor and say, oh, my kids are going to college because of you. George, come over and pray for my house. I bought a house, or I own a house. Hey, I have my retirement. I'm going to do it. Then you know what I say? Won't he do it? It's God that does it. God gave you the time. God gave you the talent to be able to do that. And then you know what else you do whenever you celebrate it is? You tell God, I got the receipts. Because that's you operating in your gift. Someone say operating your gifts. Okay, gotcha. Four of them, time, talent. Third, temple. God blesses you. All right? So I told you I don't have a tattoo. But this would be Psalms 24 and 1. Then we got what? Ephesians 2 and 10. Then I got 3 John 2. Come on now. That's great. Wave at me if this be your scripture too. Beloved means I love you. Beloved, I pray that you prosper, be in health, even as your soul prospers. And I can go King James, but prospereth. So the first thing is that when he's saying, go on a journey, and he's saying that your temple, that's your temple. When they're saying, go on a journey, your temple is mind, body, and spirit. God wants you, back to the horse again, God wants you to prosper in those three areas all at the same time. Do you see that? So, and then when she used the word prosper, it's not saying prosper like just money. It's saying to go on a good journey. So when you're going somewhere, you want to equip all things at the exact same time. So you're equipping them. So here, let's start with your soul prospering first. So again, I'm Pastor George with Faithful Central Bible Church. Where are some opportunities here at this church, Pastor George, for you to prosper your soul? Okay, number one is do soap daily. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry, somebody's new. It's like, okay, wait, am I going to go down and get some soap? I'm going to go down and get some? Okay, we do a daily Bible study, and soap stands for scripture. Help me out if you know it. Observations, application, and prayer. One more time. Scripture. That means what is the text? Observation. What does the text say? Applications. How do I apply it? And then P, we pray. Okay? Then, number two, there's something that you can do. You can actually join a group. Do we have groups? Okay, you can join a group. She popped up quick. Okay, that was perfect. Good. So you need to, there's groups. There's men's groups. There's women's groups. There's different groups that you can join. And then you can join and work together with somebody. And why is that important? The Bible says that iron sharpens iron. So you do that and you work together. Also, you can go to our website at faithfulcentral.com and you click on groups. And they'll have information like that and you can do it. Then number three, which I want to give everybody credit for today, you can come to church on Sunday and worship. And you can learn, and then what's written down, and then I want to tell you, I really appreciate it. I see so many people either writing or typing and doing this, is that take what you're learning, and then I'll apply it during the week and start actually walking into those things. And then number four, have a prayer life where you pray every day. You pray and you do that, okay? So that's soul prospering. And then second, it says be in health. You guys, eat right. Work out a little bit. Have some plan of that. Okay, I got four hand claps over here. Okay. I'm going to come over here. Anybody over here want to work out? Just can we go on a walk? You want to go for a walk? Okay, all right, cool. Can we just go for a walk? You know, during a lunchtime, I don't know if they had to come back to work, or you guys know during the pandemic when people were working from home, one of the things you do is start doing, when you do a meeting, do a walking meeting where you walk. Right, so walk around the state, you know, just do a walk and do that. And you know what else? You know what we call those? I call them, whenever you guys come to our classes, we call them wealth walks. Because what you're doing is your health is your wealth. Remember, that's your time, your talent. Start doing that walking. Then eating right. Just eat the right food and everything like that. Because you guys, we had such, man, the pandemic was hard on me. You know when you go to college and they say you gain the freshman 15? Man, when COVID hit and we were at home, I gained COVID-19 twice. I gained so much weight. But you know what, though? It wasn't my fault. It's completely my kids' fault. It's not my fault. My daughter, I used to sit there, and she would come downstairs, and I'd sit there, and she'd say, Daddy, can I get some fruit snacks? You guys ever seen those little fruit snacks? They have them little bags. It's tiny, ain't they? Only like three little things in there. She'd say, Daddy, can I get some fruit snacks? I said, yeah. Go over there. I said, go over there and get one and bring Daddy back three. Yeah. It's completely their fault. Then my sons would come downstairs. Dad, let me get some Doritos. Does anybody know what's in those bags? Anybody know those bags? Yeah. Air. There's air and just a couple little chips. So I was like, hey, yeah, give me three of them. Yeah, give me three of them. So eating fruit snacks and chips, that stuff, your temple isn't built to be run on that. Eat fresh, healthy. Accountability partners, like talk those things and have a plan and be intentional with that. Somebody say drink water and I'll move on. Come on, I clear the temple. God bless you with time. God blesses you with a talent. God blesses you with temple. Then God bless you one more area. Treasure. God bless you with finances. So you remember I told you mindset change? See, God is your source. So when we were up there singing earlier, when I'm gonna say Patrick and also Kirk, when Kirk was singing, he switched the song to Jehovah Jireh. So just so we're clear, and then Patrick said this, is Jehovah Jireh means the Lord who provides. So I want to explain something to you, and I'm going to explain it to you. God is our source. God provides everything that we need. We have no lack. Any thing you hear about lack is a lie from the pit that's been told to you. I've already said that. So when God is our provider, we have to operate and be good stewards over what he's blessed us with. Okay? So now, this text is a longer text and probably couldn't go on my shoulder, so I have to kind of go on my leg. Matthew 25:14-30. But I'm just going to show you 15 through 18. But you guys, I have CD tapes, website, everything that goes over the whole thing. But I just want to tell you this. A man goes on a journey. he entrusts three servants. To one, he gives 5 talents. To one, he gives 2 talents. To the other, he gives 1 talent. Oh, here it comes. This will save your, this will change your life. The one with 5 went at once and gained 5 more. Somebody say he doubled it. The one with 2 was given half as much as the other, went out with 2 and doubled it. The one with 1 went out and buried it in the ground. How do we bury our blessings, our talent, our skill, our time, and our money? How do we bury that financially? We bury it by just getting credit cards, right? Just run up credit cards, right? You guys know credit cards, right? Okay, nobody knows what credit cards are, okay. Plastic crack, right? Right, it's very similar, right? Right, you swipe it, you get an artificial high, right? Second thing, Wiser, it's wrong, but you do it anyway, right? Everybody knows it's wrong. You knew you shouldn't have had that dress, or you shouldn't have had that outfit, or you don't have to buy that TV with 4K, all that stuff. Now, ladies, if you can afford, I'm talking right. They say stick to the sermon, right? If you can afford the shoes, get them. But if that's your rent money, mortgage money, or it's slowing you down from your business, no, I'm not trying to fight with you. I'm just asking you to think about it. Because later on, I'm going to go with an investing and show you like how you can have the shoes and that. You know, I'll stop. I'll tell you right now. It's not that you can't have it. It's that you need to own the companies that you guys are just sporting around wearing their clothes all the time. My kids go into Costco. I'm not giving a stock recommendation, but they know I own shares of the company because they see how I act in there. Like, hey, Dad, can I get a shirt? Sure can. Because all you're doing is getting them dividends in there for me. Just go ahead and get that. That's all I'm saying. But you want to start managing and stewarding your gift. If you adjusted a talent for inflation, it'd be worth over $250,000. So God gave this one man over $1 million. Gave the other man, another person, over $500,000. And then someone in here is going to say, I was never given $500,000 or $1 million. That's not true. Okay. Everybody, just for a moment, calculate how much money you've made since you've been 18. Calculate it, and then bring it over here and set it right here on this table. No, I'm gonna wait. Want me to wait? Come here and set it right over here on this table. You know why sometimes we struggle to do that? Because we spent it all. If you had taken a portion of that and invested it in the very companies that you were buying all them clothes and stuff at, you would have the clothes and the company. Okay, we good? Sorry, we ain't trying to hit you. That hurt, but hey, look, you guys, do that and then also talk to parents. Teach us generational wealth. I'll never forget it. During the pandemic when I was eating all the, you know, other than eating fruit snacks and chips and all that stuff, I'm sitting at home, I'll never forget it. My son Alexander comes downstairs and begins to actually cuss. He says, hey, Dad, can you give me some money to buy some Robux? For all of you who don't know what that is, there's a game called Roblox, and then they buy the game. They buy stuff to play inside of a virtual game. So then I informed my son a rule, a Thompson rule. You know, somebody's trying to keep up with the Joneses. I'm trying to keep up with the Thompsons, right? I said, your dad doesn't use real money to buy fake things. That should resonate with somebody. He puts his head down and gets ready to go upstairs. I said, hey, wait, Alexander, come back. Hey, look, this company Roblox just went public. Hey, let's buy a share of the company. His head lifts up. He runs upstairs, gets his brother and his sister. They run downstairs. They said, Daddy, Alexander said that you bought the company Roblox. Hold on. I want you to listen to what I'm saying right now. That's actually true. When you own a share of a company, you own that company. If you guys think I'm playing, look at the four of the wealthiest people, Walmart. You guys understand that? Walmart, these companies. So I said, I said, yes, we own a share. Then they all stick their chests out. They said, we're gonna go upstairs and tell all our friends at school that we own Roblox. I stuck my chest out. I said, you go up there and tell all your friends that your daddy bought you Roblox, and if they want to do it, they call your daddy. Tell somebody he's a good father. What did I teach right there? I taught them we don't buy fake stuff. And if they want to play the game, I don't care now because why? I own the company. And then when you go, I'm just naming these companies, Target, Walmart, Apple, these companies you guys go to. Amazon. I'm sorry. She was like, you forgot Amazon. Did I tell you not to shop there? No. I'm just saying own the company. Ownership. You guys, there are four attributes that people that operate in God's blessing, when God blesses them, that they're very good at. I'm going to list all four to you. And I'm going to do something called bump and run. I'm going to list them, but I'll go into them a little bit, but then we'll have to do follow-up a little bit with it, okay? Number one aspect that people look at is income. You need to look at how your income comes in. You need to have more income than your outgo. Everybody understands that? So then, if you live in the state of California, I know you're watching from all over the world, most people that are doing really, really well financially have more than one stream of income. So, I mean, here in L.A., people got a job, a part-time job, and a side hustle. Then when you lose one job, then you just kind of transfer over to the other job and say, can I be full-time? But you want to have it coming in from the north, south, east, and west. You should be looking at your talents, your skill, and look at how you can monetize that. You should look at how you can do that. There's no skill that you have that you shouldn't be monetizing. You should be very successful. And then also, we already said it, God didn't put you here just to sustain you. He put you here to be able to dominate in these areas. And the reason why we struggle in these areas is because we have to look at how we're going to dominate, not just survive. So that's why you look at your income, and then you want to get multiple streams of income. Or if you have one and you have a gift and it's just really, really, really working, then you do that, and then you save and invest, okay? I'll go on that next. First is income. The second is people that are really good financially do good. Everybody know what good says? Good. G-O-O-D. Get out of debt. People that are good financially get out of debt. And there's some plan for that. As when I speak around the country, and also I wrote a book about it and everything, is that we are fortunate, me and my wife are fortunate, we live here, and when we lived in here at Inglewood, we owned a home, and we paid the home off here in Inglewood in 5.5 years. So, and that was done from being very intentional. There was never, you understand, like when I'd be doing certain things. Whenever I got any extra income, I was using it to pay down. There's principal and interest. And just not getting too deep into this, but the first 5 years of the mortgage is pretty much all interest. So you have to start making what's called principal payments to be able to pay that down. So you want to have a very specific strategy on how you're going to do that. And by the way, we're going to start a process in July here that I'll talk to you about at the end. So I'll put up the website, because at the end of the 7, a lot of people ask me how you do it. But there's actually a process, and I have videos on that. And then also I'm going to teach live sessions so everybody here knows how to get completely debt-free. Okay? And the people, to the people that have never seen that before, it is the most free thing that you ever did. I thought paying off my mortgage was the best day. Actually, it was a month later. I was driving down the street, and I said, I don't have to make a mortgage payment. I went down to Fox Hills Mall and just started buying everything a la carte just to show, like, hey, I have a mortgage payment. Get in the process of making sure you have a plan for you to get out of debt. Third, you need to learn how to invest. You want to take what God has and learn how to multiply it. So if you don't know how to invest, then start learning. Like maybe if you need a financial advisor, we can talk about that. But just start just being intentional about what's happening with your money. So what you do is you start to learn about it and everything like this. And we have classes here and we do that. But just start to learn about how does this going to increase and start to think about that. And then also, last week, Pastor John Paul Foster stood right here and he said something that was actually very, and then also just ran in the video. He was ministering out of 2 Timothy 1 and 7. He said, God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but, oh, it says Timothy, but he gave us the power of power, love, and it says self-discipline, but it's a sound mind. Do you know that more people have lost in investing by not doing it than doing it? I'm not saying everything's guaranteed. There are things that don't work out, and there's things that are doing it, but at least start trying and having some plan. Because the biggest mistake I think people make is they don't try. They don't do it. There are some times when things don't work out, but then you keep doing them. The same if you open up a business and it didn't work, come back and try it again. Just try it again a different way under wisdom. Does that make sense? Cool. And then the fourth thing that people do, they have a generational wealth plan for their family. Thank you. Thank you for that. Just a generational plan. Unfortunately, I had someone in my family pass away last year in Mississippi, and when I landed, they said, hey, before the funeral, George, we know you do stuff with estate planning. Hey, we want to talk about their estate. I'm sorry about the cuss in a minute. I said, do something about their estate. I said, oh. I said, but we're going to the funeral tomorrow, right? I said, that's in probate. I'm sorry, I think that's where we're. Sorry. If you guys know what probate is, it's years of stuff that has to sit there. You have to do the plan before, like a blueprint. And I'm just going to mention these. And they're talking about, there's something called a living trust. There's something called not only a living trust, but there's also called power of attorney. And you got to have something called health care directives. And you want to start having those. Also, you want to look at how you're going to pass things on to your children or your grandchildren. The Bible says a good person leaves an inheritance for their children's children. And how that's done is you not only pass finances to them, you also have to pass the knowledge. So that's how you all grow together in what you're doing. Thank you. I want to pray for you in a moment, but how champions are built for victorious living is you're good over your time, your temple, your talent, and your treasure, and you have them all move together the exact same way. And then I also want to say something about giving. So also a little mindset change is that we all just be able to tithe, but let's give in all four areas. Your time and your talent and your temple means that you may also volunteer at the church. So you remember time, talent, temple? Is that may be something where, let's say you're an accountant. Maybe if you can sing, hey, boom, you can go right there, Kurt. If you're an accountant, you can help that way. If you're a lawyer, you can help with, there are certain things we're doing in the community. We're doing all this outreach. We're doing things. Look at how you can give 10% of your time as a starting block. And then also 10% of your resources financially. So you're giving in all four areas. And also, you guys, just so we're clear, is this. God, do you remember I said in Psalms 24 and 1, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness therein? That means God gives you 100%. Just real quick, when you tithe, you're not paying tithes. What you're doing is you're bringing back 10% of the 100% he gave you. Just want to explain it to you mentally, okay? Because sometimes people tip instead of tithe because they think they're doing something. You see, they're saying, oh, that was a good sermon. That was a good sermon, Pastor. Here's $20. But what you're really doing is you're just bringing back that. But if we're thankful, if we love God, we bring back 10% of our time, temple, talent, treasure. Amen? Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Hey, I want to pray for you.